Hello and welcome to Start Learning Sets, a video course where I give you a quick introduction into set theory. However, first many thanks to all the nice people on Steady or PayPal who make these videos possible. Now, for learning mathematics, set theory is so important because you can describe everything in mathematics using just sets. Indeed, you could see the field of logic together with the set theory as the foundation of mathematics. This works as follows. In the language of logic, we describe the axioms we want, the axioms of set theory. This means that we have a list of propositions assumed to be true. Then that's our starting point. We have to start somewhere. We have to put something in first. And all the things we logically get out form our world of mathematics. In this way, we then reach our goal. We can do mathematics. However, this path is way too long and needs a lot of time, such that you should never do that at the beginning of your mathematical career. Thankfully, there is a very nice shortcut that works so good that you can do a lot of mathematics without bothering about the axioms. On this path, we just learn a little bit of propositional logic and something we call naive set theory. Okay, the name seems a little bit strange, we will just call it set theory. And indeed, the only difference is that we don't write down all the axioms. With this and the propositional logic we learned in the last videos, we can go to doing mathematics. Now, by having this picture in mind, let's go to the start of set theory. So let's start by saying what a set is. One often says a set is just a collection of distinct objects into a whole. So the idea would be if we have some objects. For example, here, four different objects, then the set puts them all together into a collection. There you see, this is not a correct definition, it's just the idea we have in mind written down. Hence, it means that by putting the objects together, we get out a new thing we could call here the set M. So what makes the set M are the objects, so we have a natural relation between the objects and the set. Now, in order to make everything easier, we call such an object X inside a set M just an element of M. Or even better, we use a short formula for this. So we use this special E for element and read it as X in M. So for the example on the right hand side, we would write the circle of A is an element of M. Moreover, if X is not such an object of the collection, we write a similar thing. X is not an element in M. There we would use the line through the E. Now on the right hand side for the example, we would write this D is not an element in M. Now at this point, because you know some logic, I can say that this new notation is just a short notation for the negation of this statement. There you have it, we see the element relations as logical statements. And because a set is defined by these element relations, we can just define a set by giving all the elements. For this, one usually uses the curly brackets as we did before. So this is a set that has the number 2, the number 5, and the number 6 as elements. So inside the curly brackets, we have a list of all the elements. And please note, the order does not matter because we only need the element relation. So there's no order inside a set. Now, another useful notation we can introduce now is when I want to give the set a new name, for example, A. Then I would write colon equality. And we would read that the left-hand side is defined by the right-hand side. So it's an assignment which should remind you that a new name, a new variable is introduced at this point. Okay, now before we go into the details of set theory, I first want to show you some examples of sets that we use later. The first one is the empty set, which is the unique set that has no elements at all. And the notation we use is just a circle with a line through it. However, other people just use the empty curly brackets. Now, the following number sets we will define later correctly, but here I can already show you the symbols we use for them. For the natural numbers starting with 1, we use the n as a symbol. And for the natural numbers including 0, I use the same n with an index 0. If we include the negative numbers as well, we call them the integers and denote them by capital Z. In later videos, we will properly define these sets, but for the moment, it's a good thing that we have the number sets such that we can write down some examples. Therefore, I assume that you already know at least some things about natural numbers. Now, later when we are ready for it, we can also define the rational numbers denoted by Q, the real numbers denoted by R, and the complex numbers denoted by C. Okay, now the natural question for you would be, how can we define sets without writing down all the elements? For example, for the natural numbers, you already see the problem with this approach. Now, in order to efficiently do this, we have to go back to logic and talk about quantifiers and predicates. Indeed, I already mentioned what a predicate is. It's something with a variable, for example x, and it becomes a logical statement if we set a value for x. Therefore, x in n would be a nice example of a predicate. And quantifiers are just reversed letters a and e, and we will talk about them in the next video. Okay, I hope I see you there, and have a nice day. Bye!